Имаме денеска прекрасна можност да ќе бидат гости прекрасни луѓе. Најпрво да ги поздравам високите гости амбасадор на Европска унија во Република Македонија, министерот за транспорт во владата на Република Македонија, високата комисионерка за транспорт и мобилити на Европска унија и нашите колеги, представници од Европска унија, медиуми, најдобри студенти, имаме редка прилика да споделиме некои искуства што мислам дека ќе ни бидат корисни и по индустријска политика и по економија на еден сектор. Меѓутоа, еве како што е официјално, најпрвин нашата директорка на ЕУ-инфо центарот, колешката Даниела Ванучевска, да ја поздрави нашата гостинка и после тоа одиме со едно предавање.
Почитувани, министер во владата на Република Македонија за транспорт и врски господин Цукаревски, почитуван амбасадор Самвел Шпугар, шеф на делегацијата на Европската унија, почитуван еврокомесар за транспорт и врски на Европската унија магистер Виолета Булц, драги студенти, драги професори и колеги, представници од делегацијата на Европската унија, дозволете ми во име на деканот, но и во моја име како директор на Центарот за податоци и информации на Европската унија да ви посветам едно топло добредојде на овој убав и свечен настан денеска за нашиот факултет. Економскиот факултет продолжува со своите заложби, редовно организира предавања, трибини и дебати на актуелни теми за економскиот развој и за напредокот на Република Македонија. Во тој контекст, по иницијатива на професорот Јубо Бетикеновски, се организира единичното предавање на тема од областта за транспортите и комуникациите. Нема да должам многу, само два-три зборови сакам да истакнам. Неспорна е улогата на транспортот и комуникацијската инфраструктура за развојот на една земја воопшто. Квалитетна транспортна и комуникацијска инфраструктура представува предуслов за постојање на развиени пазари и за добро функциониращи пазари. Квалитетна и транспортна и комуникацијска инфраструктура води до намалување на регионалните и развојните диспаритети во една земја, а и меѓу земјите во регионот. Квалитетна транспортна и комуникацијска инфраструктура представува предуслов за забрзување економскиот развој во една земја и секако подобрување на економската благосостојба на нејзините граѓани. Како што најавив дека нема да должам премногу и да одземам од ова драгоцено време на комесарот, би биле одлична можноста изборно да се запознаеме со предизвиците со кои што се случува Европската унија во борбата за зголемување на конкурентноста на Европската унија, за јакнувањето на нејзините позиции на глобалните пазари, улогата што има транспортната и комуникацијската инфраструктура во тој процес, а секако ниту ние земјите од Југоисточна Европа не сме исклучени во тоа што се случува во нас во нашето окружување. Затоа, покарувам сите со едно огромно задоволство да го слушнеме инспиративното предавање на еврокомесарот Булц, кое што со своето огромно експертско искуство и познавање верувам дека ќе сподели интересни сознанија со нас. Од мене толку и посакувам да уживате во предавањето.
Само да се не изтребувам, дека овде од пат ја взимаме на катедра. Само неколку напомени. Зошто транспорт е исклучително битен за нас и ова да биде како интродакшн, како вовед во нејзиното предавање. Првата работа за ми тоа што за Македонија и за мали земји, поготово имаме сега на следна околност на амбасадор доаѓа од Словенија, министерката доаѓа од Словенија, они може да не разберат што значи мало, континентално затворено обшество. Ключна предпоставка на регионот е патната, железничката, комуникацијската инфраструктура. Ключниот проблем што го има поставено што DQ се нарекува тотално мислење или историја за вкупност на континентот. Ние денеска имаме проблем во контекстот на тоа како ја гледаме Европа. Сите експерти, условно за регионот, најдобриот од 20-тиот век, Сергеј Вегарес, кажува дека на Европа и фали третиот дел, тоа е југоисточна Европа. Балканскиот полуостров е всушност најважниот дел од Европа. Јас само инсистирам на тоа дека Европа без Балкан е како човек без нозе и дека само од Балкан се оди во големиот евразиски континент. Голем пазар, голем притисок. Македонија во овој контекст го живее собствениот парадокс. Што вика Ајнштајн, умот работи кога не е отворен, бидејќи као и Падогранот, као и Балканот, као Македонија. Ние секој пат сме били отворени за да може економски и социјално да екзистираме. И во тој контекст е исклучително битна оваа димензија на транспортите, физичките коридори кои се обележени на просторот. На коридорот 8, како европски коридор, кој е Вија Игнација, кој е патот на свилата, и коридорот 10, кој е секој пат Вија Милитарна. За Македонија е исклучително битно да проработат тие две сказалки, затоа што кај нас Саато е застана 1913 и од тогаш ние живееме со политички граници, кои се нелогични за просторните граници. Затоа тие транспортни коридори се исклучително значени, не само би рекол за Македонија, за нас особено, за тоа што без ние, без нив, двете сказалки која не работаат, не работи нашиот часот. Вториот контекст, што исклучително битен на што дојде од Европска Унија, е врзана со оваа приказка околу коридорите, и исто така значен се вика институционален коридор. Ние заборавивме колку се важни институциите, заборавивме на нивното ефикасно функционирање, и додека ги воспоставиме старите институции, веќе доаѓаме во една трета димензија, во која техниката, технологијата, иновациите ги именуваат старите институции. Што тоа значи? И тоа би било интересно да чуеме од министерката, незиниот принос во овој контекст како технолошките иновации го подобруваат не само физичките, правните коридори, туку како ја доближуваат и демократијата до секој граѓанин, кога секој на некој начин учествува директно и не бара свој посредник по некоја овај политичка сфера. Затоа мислам дека од исклучително значење за нас како Република Македонија, како регион, овој пошироко, како транспорт, да живееме во реално време и во реален простор. И во ова време имаме супер гостинка која ќе ни обезбеди дека најважната работа во транспорт и мобилите е да знаеш каде одиш. Ако знаеш каде одиш, тогаш е задача на вас, на овие генерации, да го фатат правецот таму кај што треба да стигнем, и тоа ми рекол дека не е само задача на оваа генерација, туку на неколку генерација. Да го чуеме предавањето и ќе имаме малку време за да чуеме некое прашање, да овај нешто по-конкретно што може да ни одговори министерката. What's the flu? It's yours. We're all expecting.
Добар ден, али ја чу на англиско.
Да.
Не знам македонски, или не знам и колико ми знаете балкански, така да ја чу на англиски. Стварно ми драг, I'm very happy and very pleased to be with you here today. Being a student my whole life, and I will never give up this role as well. It's always exciting to share some thoughts with younger generations, or also students. And I'm not going to have here like a professor, like a professor-style lecture. I like to have a dialogue with you. But first, just to understand where my points are coming from and the comments I will be making. First, I'd like to just tell you who I am. I really would never associate myself as being a politician. I am a citizen of this world. And I, all my life, regardless of the role that I was playing, I tried to leave this world better than I received. This is where you're going to see all my activities. Being electrical engineer by profession, then working in computer science for several years in Silicon Valley, then got, how do you call it, President's MBA from School of Management, going into business, becoming an entrepreneur, and was an entrepreneur for 14 years. And then got fed up the way how my taxes were used in Slovenia, and started to engage into a political movement that reshaped the country I know best. Without having any political ambitions, loving my professional work, my party won by 36% from zero. So we didn't have people. So they asked me to come on board as a minister. So I did. I gave up my entrepreneurial, very successful entrepreneurial lifestyle, and I became a minister. In 2 weeks I became deputy prime minister, and in 5 weeks I became European Commissioner. So I'm pretty sure that future commissioners from this country are sitting here. So what I'm trying to picture to you is the world that we live in. It's an extremely dynamic world where you create your own opportunities. Don't wait for others. Don't wait for others to create life you want to live, because they won't. They're creating life when they want to live. And I can see very positive spirit in this country. It's a lot of sunshine, not only the weather-wise. But whoever I talk to is very positive. So I hope you share this kind of spirit, and that you understand that the world and the life you want to live is in your hands. No matter how you think that this is theoretical and maybe from the books, it's not. I'm a living proof that that's not the case. And as young people, there are a couple of messages I'd like to pass to you that help me. I have to invest a lot to get to kind of embrace them, and maybe you will just take them from me for granted. There are a couple of things that make my life and my engagement extremely rewarding. First is that I always knew that I cannot do anything by myself. So I just love people, and I have full trust in people. And the full trust and capacity is that we are able, together, as a collective thinkers, with extremely well-recognized individual capacities, to create whatever we want. Maybe you can pick it up, or maybe you just have this in you already, and you will just say, yes, I knew it. The other one is, try to avoid judgments. They are a huge baggage in your back. We call them monkeys. That really tried to prevent you from being successful. Don't judge. You never know what the full story is. But be very strong in communication and try to present your own views and try to engage people. They believe in what you stand for. And this will empower you so strongly, because you have enough physics that you know that the energy is limited in a way that you have it. So either you can use it for dealing with problems, or you use it for dealing with opportunities. I always use it for opportunities. And interestingly enough, the problems disappear, because also according to the law of physics, from one space there is room only for one thing. Yeah? And because of that, you can use this law of physics really well for steering your life. I hope it doesn't sound too sweet, because it's true. And sometimes life is sweet as well. But behind that, it's not an easy task. I'm not trying to make it like an easy walk through the woods. A lot of energy goes into acknowledging the reality that we live in, into recognizing opportunities, and into learning. That's why I said I hold my life, I'm a student. That's why it's okay either you collect diplomas or you just collect capacities, but never stop learning. That's the weakest point also of all member states in the Western Balkan region, including Slovenia, that most of the people stop learning before they are 42. And this is something, please stimulate your parents, stimulate your uncles and aunties and whoever is older than you are, that they never stop learning. I will show you just in the case of transport. Today's world, because of the digital technologies and the new business models that are emerging, because the world is becoming one big marketplace, the changes that are happening are so quick that we need to readjust the way how we interact with these changes and really be able to absorb, to change, and of course to engage with new knowledge in, like we eat every morning breakfast or maybe lunch or dinner. And this is your sort of responsibility, because you still remember what it is to acknowledge, not to acquire knowledge. And those that know have a responsibility to teach those that don't know. Please never forget that. So don't blame people who don't know. Blame yourself that you have not communicated your knowledge well enough for them to know it as well. And that will empower you as a community, and that will empower you as a human being. And that will really position you really well in the modern world. Are you still with me?
Yes.
Okay, now a couple of words about transport. I will tell you now how I try to really bring all this into transport. First of all, I 100% agree with what the professor said, that transport is the driver of both economical and social prosperity. Because more you're connected, more you're free. And it's not only philosophy, it works also in the physical sense. So that's why, if you want to be successful in business, if you want to be successful in internationalization of your ideas, if you want to be successful in engaging in a global community, you need connectivity. And today, connectivity is transport, energy, and digital. Where transport is not only one of the three forces, but it's also the biggest user of energy and digital today. And if you take a look at the Silicon Valley, and if you take a look also at European level, in Silicon Valley, more than 60% of investments today are in mobility. New mobility solutions, technologies, development of new models, partnerships, concepts. And that tells you a lot. Because mobility, as we know it today, will be very different by 2030. It's going to be dramatically different by 2050. And that's what we are working on. I know that you're dealing in this country still with essential challenges of the basic transportation needs. But it's okay if you deal with that, but deal it in the spirit of 2030 and 2050. What does that mean? These are my priorities. Priorities of European transport that I was able to develop together with my colleagues right at the beginning when we took over, in the spirit of overall European Commission. You probably know how many really difficult moments we had in the last 2 years and a half. Economical crisis on social level started to steer extreme views of Europe again. We had never seen before crisis with refugees. We just didn't know how to deal with it because Europe was everybody. Everybody was moving away from Europe. All of a sudden, massively, people wanted to come to Europe. That was a serious challenge. The second one, terrorism, that has never been into that scale present in Europe. And then, if that was not enough, Brexit happened, the vote for Britain to leave the European Union. And, of course, at the end, Trump happened, and the whole global situation was completely put into a different perspective. So all that in only 2.5 years. Usually it took 20 years to accumulate such a dramatic changes. But EU proved to be a very mature political arena. We can argue in details if we done all right or not. But in principle, we were able to develop tools, we were able to develop frameworks in order to manage and master the challenges that came with all these situations. And that is where I gain confidence. And transport has been all the time an essential part of all these challenges. It was either a victim, it was used to show the power of, for example, terrorism. Even in it's the third most important topic in negotiation with Britain, besides people, finances, and border issues. Yeah? And that tells you how mobility is really important. And for us, in, on European level, we address this need for ever development, for prosperous and inclusive and accessible transport by focusing on two core objectives: efficiency and connectivity. So we want all solutions in EU to be as efficient as possible, because right now we are fragmented, we are not using the new technologies well, and it's a rather old-minded sector. And life provides, right? They got the team around board and it's all about that. And the other one is connectivity, to ensure that new member states are well connected, to ensure that the neighborhood is well connected, and to ensure that we are well connected globally with our other continents, where the growth is and where we see also opportunities for either political or business engagements. And that's our very clear strategy. Everything you will see that we do on EU level in transport, it will result at the end in a tangible results and KPIs, key performance indicators on these two issues. But in order to get there, we had to pick some core enablers, and you see them already there. I can go through all of them, but for the sake of discussion today, and because I really would like to give you opportunity to ask questions and to steer today's discussion, if you don't, I'm going to go back to my presentation. But if you do, you will have a chance. I will focus only on one, which I hope it will be the most exciting one for you: digitalization. I know that this country is really strong in that, and I am inviting everyone, all stakeholders, and you in particular, use this as a strength. And even in mobility, you cannot even imagine how many opportunities nowadays is bringing digitalization on board and creating SME startups and also to lead the change in the way how you position your country as well. What are the most exciting things? In digitalization, we're focusing on a couple of elements. First is decarbonization, to bring digital new technologies that help to lower the impact of transport on the environment. We contribute 24% of fossil emissions, and if we don't do dramatic changes, this will become the biggest polluter by 2030. So we are engaging on all levels, shifting cargo from roads to railways, bringing green technologies in a sense of propulsion systems, in a sense of traffic management on board. This will never be possible if we didn't have digital means. So, hope you will find some opportunities for you in this area. The other digitalization importance is the efficiency itself and making sure that we remove the administrative burdens from the logistics systems. Here, with all our initiatives, lately we have Europe on the Move, which comes in three packages in July, in November, and next year in March, where we are really after efficiency and trying to bring over 60% of administrative burdens down. How? To ensure that all data that can be exchanged between two countries can be exchanged directly between two countries. Alignment of databases, protocols, and all the agreements that are necessary that the countries can send, not only if they are willing, but they are mandatory. It's mandatory to send information. Think about your country as well. How can you do the same with other countries and with the EU? The second element is business to administration. With lots of information we need in order to verify if people are legally working on single market, if people are legally engaging on regional cooperation. So all this data can be exchanged also through databases. We're establishing now databases on EU level that the businesses will report directly to countries information they need to report. And last but not least, we are empowering the modes by itself. For example, in the road sector, trucking business, with modern digital tachographs that all the control officers on the road can do a high quality control and avoid fraud that is so strongly present currently on the road sector in the EU. And that should be interesting for you too. So, but this is just an example. What we are working right now is the key digital push is going towards cooperative and autonomous driving. We see these first steps on autonomous driving everywhere. We see it in railways, where we have more and more autonomous trains. We see it in smart city solutions, where we have more and more public transport moving towards autonomous drive. We see it in unmanned ships that are now tested and soon to be deployed, the first on in inland waterways and on the sea. And in aviation, we see drones coming on board, and by the end of the year, EU will have a legal system for the engagement of drones in business modeling as an active element of future mobility. So here are the exciting parts. Autonomous cars. We have now first testing beds. Germany, France, and Luxembourg defined the first real-time testing beds in a real environment for cooperative and autonomous driving. Slovenia, Hungary, and Austria are about to announce the second one. Germany, Netherlands, and Belgium are about to announce the third one. No reason that you would not get engaged yourself with this cross-border cooperation with maybe one or two countries from the region. We will be more than happy to see you being engaged and with us on EU level for exchange of good practices and further moves in legislation that will need to be done. In November, in Finland, we will present so-called urban aviation space, which will allow, and we will test by 2019, first flying cars to be fully engaged in mobility solutions, especially in smart cities level. So all that is digitalization. All that is giving opportunities to those that want to get engaged, because you can jump a few phases. We walk the path for you. Come on board on a modern level. And I have a confidence after signing a very important document called Transport Community Treaty in Trieste this summer, and with a high level of engagement of your minister, who's sitting here now, and your government in signing this for your country as well, that you will use these opportunities that come. Why? Because this is a legal framework, predictable framework for the investments in transport. And you need that in order to attract investments. And you know that every year, students of economy, most of them, yes? So you know that 1% of investments in infrastructure means 2.4% at least of increase of GDP in the next 4 years. So these are very strong messages. And now you're walking this path. That's really encouraging. And I want you to be more engaged directly and try to partner as much as you can through projects in the region, especially within the declared regional economical area, where all VB6 countries will be able to engage and then further cooperate with the European Union. And in the middle of all these developments and positive agenda where EU is moving forward, where we have now positive GDP in all member states, where we are de facto now the strongest economy in the world, also comes the announcement of President Juncker that in February we will publish a new strategy for enlargement of EU. So I hope I can pass this excitement and opportunity spirit also to you, and that you see yourself as creators of the future, not only of your country, not only of the European Union, but the world. I mean, the world is such a small place, and especially through digital means, this is even smaller. And that's your strength. That's a real privilege. Use it. Build the life you want to live in. Don't allow anyone to take your dreams away. Thank you.
Dobro, lahko da vidim on the board, on the stage. Zajedno, da videme spremni za vprašanjeta, nešto mnogo konkretno.
Whatever you want.
To je nenadvano tema. Jasno je, zašto u Ljubljana se radija zmajčiki. Ja ću da se vika zmajčiki, žena zmaj. Сега да кажам нешто конкретно зашто нас би интересирало. На една страна се раѓа еден економски джин на исток. Имаме конкретна иницијатива One Belt One Road. Две недели пред ходно бевме во Охрид, од Конфуција од Словенија, институтот од Лјубљана го иницираше тоа. Таму имаме конкретни проекти на коридор Кичево, Охрид, има некој конкретен предлог, идеја за Вардар Морава. За нас е исклучително битно тоа, заради тоа што пак зборувам за тоа дека овде не треба да зборува политика, а да зборува регион. Тогаш кога просторот диктира, тогаш имате логика дека Ротердам Солун е клучната кичма на Европа. 1856 е формирана таа компанија во Бостон. После 100 и кусур години ние повторно работиме на тој проект. Дали тие проекти се конкурентни, спротиставени? Што добива Македонија од тоа? Тоа е многу битно за мене, као иницијација на некои студенти да прашат
курс. I'd like to let you know how Europe functions in that respect. We don't decide about the projects. We bring countries together and invite them to define the corridors within which they want to operate. Of course, we have the interest that is in corridor logic. We're very much in everywhere engaged in corridor logic. That's why Europe has 9 major corridors to really transport through which we connect all member states, and these corridors we then extended to VB6 through in 2014 the maps were signed, and this year the treaty was signed, and now already we are financing several projects in the region, among the biggest single project that got finances right after the signature of treaty in Trieste is a project here, is the railway towards Bulgaria. So I'd like you to understand that you need to engage with your partners, and together with partners that you connect, you define the priorities, and together you have to lobby. Lobbying is not a crime. We have a very strict rules how you can do it, but you have to do it, because that's the only way you bring attention. Yeah? You need to, and we need to hear your voice. Yeah? Then another thing is that we have many different financial mechanisms in place, and EU has learned in the last 60 years that how to deal with projects, and we're getting better and better also in the governance of projects. So if any kind of European institutions you want us to get engaged, we are very much requiring transparency and clear project management that is strictly monitored through all the phases, and as soon as we see now, we improved our governance models, as soon as we see that things are not going the right direction, we stop the access to funding. A new MFF will go even stronger in this direction. That applies now to all my funding, which is the corridor funding of the European Transport. So, but any other financial institutions are more than welcome. What we are even establishing, as you mentioned, connectivity platform with China, where we try to align our standards and try to align our regulatory frameworks, and then jointly decide the priorities on the investments that we can both capitalize from. But we are strongly advising against any kind of engagement with financial institutions or individuals that will move you away from European standards. Because if you move away from European standards, then you will not be able to connect to our backbones, and then it's going to be a problem. Trains will all of a sudden have to stop, or trucks will not be allowed to go further, or any other consequence of that can follow. So it is of our interest, that's why we communicate with all our global friends. I almost feel like I'm a salesperson, because I travel with a suitcase of European projects all around, London, New York, Frankfurt, Paris, and sell European projects as the best investments to institutional investors and individual investors, but under the rules of standardization and transparency. So this is something that should lead you, and you as future project creators or project holders, if you want to cooperate with the single market, or if you want to cooperate with the EU as a whole. But every decision in transport, because it's a corridor logic, has to be done within the corridor spirit, and you have to seek the support from your partners.
На вас е лед. Дайте да поставиме простор, кой може да остане и всякъде на английски, всякъде на македонски. Ние лесно да ги помислиме тук.
If not, think about it. I will share another project which is very exciting. We were asked, I was asked four, 3 years ago, just I started with my method, maybe I was 6 months into it. I had a citizens' dialogue in Ljubljana, and with lots of people, really exciting. And at one point, one youngster stands up and he says, "What do you do for mobility of the youth, for the youth mobility in Europe?" And I really didn't have an answer. I'm not aware of any specific project, but that did not land well within me. I was disturbed a little by this question. So. About less than a year later, there were a couple of German students that pushed the German minister and one political MEPs, members of the European Parliament, what do you do for European mobility? That was the next very strong message that came on our table. And in less than half a year, we put together a youth mobility project, which is now in the first phase of testing. Where we are learning how to provide youth with the yearly tickets, traveling vouchers for free, that they can experience EU. So this year we were able to engage 2 million euros. We dedicated that just as a pilot project. All member states got a portion of it. Next year we will continue with slightly adjusted projects through European Parliament, and in the next new MFF program, based on these two experiences, we will put together a mobility project for the youth. So it doesn't matter if you stand up and speak up, because we listen. Anyone? I thought you guys are very engaging and outspoken. All my friends from this country that studied with me in Ljubljana, they were always the best students, always very outspoken, always engaging. You know Jordan Jovanovski? Have you heard from him? Of him? One of the biggest minds in artificial intelligent neural networks. No? He was my schoolmate. He lives in Ljubljana. But his market is the world. He does everything from his
sleep. Нещо за пътуване вас, нещо за виза.
How many of you have contributed to any European project so far? Has anybody got engaged so far in any European project? No? None of you? Ever?
Did you choose for the Eros project?
Nobody, no Erasmus students here? Ah, professor, there's work to do.
What is the problem of connectivity? Никой не бил на размена или не на Америка студите, него на европски Erasmus програми и така само.
Okay, so now you have a work to do. Which year students are you?
You want? Third and fourth.
Okay, those that are third, you still have a chance. Try to get engaged. I mean, I'm not going to be too proud of having two kids and not seeing them anymore much, but they really use the opportunities of these different programs, and they've seen Europe, and they really have a different view of life, opportunities. So get engaged, go out, don't be afraid, and engage with your fellow students. You will be a connected generation. You know, who knows what kind of models you will invent. But if you don't have good partners around the world, it will be hard to be successful with that. With your thoughts. Okay. engage with you. You will see all of a sudden how incredible you are. Because if you don't engage, you always think that it would be the others are better. Or, you know, if you're born in a modern country, let's say California or Germany or Finland or Britain or Slovenia, well, these guys are already privileged. They're not. They're not. I left for California when I finished my graduation in Ljubljana, and I was really scared that I will not be able to cope with that Silicon Valley high level of standards of education. It was one of the best students at that time. So my confidence has grew at that time substantially. And when I started to engage with my colleagues at work, I actually was very proud of my multicultural environment that we have in Balkans, an understanding of serious challenges that life can present you with, and you never give up. And that was the spirit that got me far. So be proud of these characteristics. Yeah? Because that's what at the end matters. Knowledge can be acquired, but people matter. What is in your heart, what is in your spirit, what is in your beliefs and visions really matters. And you have it. I assure you, we are from the same region. I know. That's it then? No questions?
We don't go in. I'm
not going to
look
at yeah,
I will add something from experience that to share with the audience and maybe with you. I was a former Minister of Finance for 3 years, long ago, 2006-2009. And believe me, the major transport network in Macedonia has been built so far, and I hope it will be built in the future, with assistance of EU funds. We use generously funds from the European Investment Bank, which are under very favorable terms. I would add to your remark about European standards and what does it mean. Sometimes if you are not prepared, it can delay your projects for years. For example, you know this portion of the Corridor 10, which is almost finished. I hope the minister will cut the ribbon soon, maybe early next year. Dimitar Kapi's small piece, the last portion of the corridor of the highway from north to south. So, in speaking with partners, neighboring countries, etc., we had a very bad experience with Greece. You know, they had a very interesting plan that they will help Balkans, and they committed and they promised 50 million euro, I think, for this corridor, for this. When I was minister at that time, and nothing happened. Even one occasion, I was forced to declare that we will find ways to finish this corridor, even not using the non-existent Greek funds. Fortunately, the European Investment Bank came in, and the project was financially viable. Now, about the standards. We lost as a country 1 or 2 years because you know our planners were not aware about the width, the Shirinatana, Lenditana of the buttons of the lines now. First, they were not proposed as European Union demands. Second, environmental standards. I think we lost additional year because our planners did not have in mind that a very rare species of bats existed in the mountains. Always on there. So, actually, immediately, the European mountainous region. And so, European Union said, okay, you should take care and find another. So, in addition to this, I'm not sure why you decided to focus on digitalization. I think that, from our perspective here, it may be too optimistic. As always, we'll wait for Europeans to dump their cars here, so we will drive them for additional decade or two, and wait for autonomous vehicles, so electric vehicles will be very expensive for this region and standards of living.
Well, that's your problem. I hope you won't do that. You won't allow that. I would very much encourage what you said about standards and frameworks, and that makes the whole investment environment predictable, reliable, and you can attract investors. But on the other hand, don't become a trash hole. Don't become a dustbin. You don't need that. Really not. That's why today, in parallel with my visit, there is also a Summit 100, a big summit of businesses and governments of the region. And the key message is to move forward on electrification. You know, it's been really clear that by 2030, from 2030 on, you will no longer be able to register diesel and cars with propulsion systems based on that. So that was a clear message. But not only Slovenia, Germany made an announcement, France made an announcement, and things are moving faster than you think. That's why corridors like Green Balkanica, Green Adriatica, ENISO, these are regional projects where all member states are now engaging in the region in order to walk the path together with the EU. Especially good message from here is that the region has its own resources to run them. One of the reasons why EU decided to go into electrification and modernization through alternative energies, being LNG or different variations of electrification, is because we were too much dependent on oil. 92% of all European transport depends on oil. You know how the fluctuation of prices in oil is. You know that we don't have, this is not our own resource. So we need to lower the risk of exposure and protect our economy in a way that can be competitive without political instability of certain regions. So that's why we decided to go towards, push towards alternative fuel infrastructure. We are now co-investing in all member states alternative fuel infrastructure from November on. Special financial tools have been developed, innovative financial mechanisms. And I hope that Western Balkans will use this. And I said, whenever you deploy infrastructure, think about the modern terms. You don't need to walk all the steps that we walked. Walk the modern way. And I'm encouraged by what I see here. Minister can share maybe a little bit more with you what your plans are. But this is encouraging because the whole region stepped together. And you're going to have our secretariat where your country will play an important role. You will have an important position in it, and through that secretariat you will be aligning even further all the activities with EU. So I believe that these positive trends, these positive engagements, these positive new tools that we have developed together, and the investments that are already underway should be a good signals and make sure that you stay modern. Yeah? It is your responsibility that you propose projects that include already these modern trends. And I can see the region is ready. You don't need to be too skeptical. Just get engaged. Get engaged, that's the only way. I would never be European Commissioner for Transport and Mobility if I sit at home and complain to my parents or my kids and wait for somebody else to make a difference. No. I stepped in and I was a co-creator of these changes. And I continue to do so now on European level. And will continue to do so my life, wherever I will get
engaged in the future. Super. Dve navode se bitni. I moja ideja više da go prašam, mislio da ga je tuka, nije se kao profesor, da ja sam bar te tri ravnoti što se aktuelno. Zašto mislim da je bitna ova ravnota? Apropo autata, zašto zemat me nije stari auta, site i frla, dizel nije se naduvame kao mali deca na dizel. Međutim, imamo zagadovanje ovako kako što imamo. И затоа треба да го имаме предвид тоа што започна со тој DNHU и со конгигтуити. Тоа е тоталносна биолошката, социолошката, просторната и временската димензија во која живееме. Значи, ние живееме заедно со нив. Одлуката е наша, дали ќе увеземе 150.000 автомобили и ќе се гушиме од тука до јуни, или ќе донесеме одлука као Словенија, не се жали никому, 2030 не ни треба дизел. Тоа е неполитичка одлука за да комуницираш ти со твоите бирачи, па сега да се удвараме.
Не, него тоа е во интерес на следните генерации. Затоа реков дека оваа генерација што сте и што сме е континуитет, е штафета, трика некоја друга генерација да оставиме почист воздух. Тоа е исклучително битно. Втората работа за дигитализација. Зошто е кај нас мислам најбитно тоа? Затоа што слабите институции, познати сме по тоа сите на Балкана, најлесно се заменуваат со дигитална технологија. Место ти да комуницираш и да го контролираш, твојот градоначалник, еве денеска после овие избори, на 4 години со гласање ти можеш да го контролираш секој ден. Аутобусот кога води, картата која доведуваш, платформите како Uber, Netflix, сите се тие нови демократски решенија, не само во однос на транспортот, него ти стануваш суќе. Но, би сакал да го искористиме министерот во истиот контекст, затоа што Македонија го живее својот парадокс. Евроскептицизмот расте, ние не сме осетиле што е тоа Европа, да питнеш, затоа што треба да нешто да биде tangible, нешто што е, што вика Кейнс, на долг рок сите сме мртви. Значи ние мора нешто сега да направиме за да видат како завршува коридорот 10, како продолжува коридорот 8, бидејќи не знам за кого е срамота. Меѓутоа, последната пруга во Македонија е направена 1872 од Отомански империја. 150 години ние се возиме на пругите од Турско.
In Slovenia, so.
Апропо тие два на овој дела, е, и конкретно околу ова водена ова линија за силата на Варварската долина, барем до кај се статусот на овие проекти во Македонија, да искористиме вашето
And while he's coming, that's why we put 92% of all our investments in our railways to modernize railways, and I'm really glad that, your country is doing the same.
Добро дано, почитувани присутни, почитувани студенти. Значи, би сакал да одговорам на оно што предходно ви повикам, од едно прво на железничката инфраструктура. Значи, 70 милиони евра добивме во Трст во јуни месец, како држава по заслуга на редно на комесарот, Јолита, и тие се внесуваат на втората делница од Мелјаковци до Крива Паланка. На третата денница од Крива Паланка до угарската граница, која што ќе биде и најскапа. Таква е конституцијата на земјиште до таму, ќе чини прилично доста. Мислам дека дополнителни 60 милиони евра ќе добиеме неповратни средства. Е, сега во делот на Битола Кременица, сакам да кажам. Штаво, имавме ситуација каде што договорот беше раскинет. Ово стоит сега во моментов имаше евалуација, каде што треба да биде до крајот на месец подпишен договор со изведувачот. И планираме за да искористиме дел од тие средства, оваа пруга, Битола до Кременица, мора да отпочне до крајот на годината, за да не ги изгубиме тие па средства кои што од тоа министер на Тајна на Финанси знае беше, се преслала на бюджетот на Република Македонија. И затоа ние правиме се да отпочне, тоа се надеваме дека уште ноември месец се отпочне изградбата на тази со цел до крајот на наредната година, таа да биде завршена. Во делот на Великапија Стопница, че двата проблеми кои што ги имаше неколку месеци и ги надминеме, Министерството за транспорт и вас издаде одобрение за градба и за дислокација на новото на МЕПСО, исто така и за изградбата на контролниот центар во Неготин. Очекуваме до крајот на февруари да биде конкретно завршен тој дел и да од 1 март тој автопат се воси. Ова е во тие други два автопати што знаете, дека не се прекуриваат, се не се кинезат. Продолжиме рокот, веќе треба финансиски средства да ви от колегата. Правилно обеква в кредит мен. Затова ще остане възбуза сериозно висока сума, която ще трябва да ми водил от моделите, водил от на и че го пресърка с лечището, кой ще лечи с кимовече.
Благодаря. Не, да ви сме ги стигнени. Министър, значи, имате още някое отношение за край да ги изцелиме и... Добре. Я мислам дека днес имаме да любав овај ден, фокусирани на теми кои се типично наши и за индустријска политика, и за иновации, и за проблемот на економија сектор, транспортот и обшто транспортот и реализација на тој јавен интерес. И затоа сега на Министерката, Вилата Бутски, да не е сертификат од апресијейшн за незиното предавање од ДЕКА и да се заблагодариме со една нова платна.
Добро обиво Европска унија за Македонија.